Gospel according to Matthew, the 15th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus called the crowd to him and said to them, "Listen and understand. It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but what it is that comes out of the mouth that defiles." Then the disciples approached him and said to him, "Do you know that the Pharisees took offense when they heard what you said?" He answered, "Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Let them alone. They are blind guides of the blind. And if one blind guide guides another, both will fall into a pit." But Peter said to him, "Explain this parable to us." Then he said, "Are you also still without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth enters the stomach and goes out into the sewer? But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this is what defiles. For out of the heart comes evil intentions, murder, adultery, fornication, theft, false witness, slander. These are what defile a person. But to eat with unwashed hands does not defile." Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Well, grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. I remember one fall day long ago when I was just a little boy playing outside with some other neighborhood kids. The leaves were already falling from the trees and we had raked up a great big pile of leaves. And like kids do, we were jumping in the pile of leaves and messing all around with them. There are about, I suppose, 8 little boys and girls out there playing in the leaves that beautiful fall afternoon. When we got tired of jumping in the leaves, we decided we'd do something creative with those leaves, and so the boys all got together, and we decided we were going to make a leaf fort. And so we piled the leaves around in a rectangle and tried to pile up the leaves high to make walls. Now, the girls asked if they could help us, but we replied, "No, no girls allowed." So the girls got together, and they made a leaf house with bedrooms for each girl and a living room and dining room and kitchen, and they began to sit in their leaf house and walk around in their leaf rooms, and they were having a great time while the boys got bored sitting in their rectangle. And so they started to leave, and I was the only one left. And so I went over to the girls because they were having much more fun, and I said, "Could I come into their leaf house?" And one girl resolutely said, "No, there is not enough room." Well, the other girls, seeing the disappointment in my face, talked it over for a bit and said, "Yes, I could come join them if I helped them add another bedroom," which I did. And then we added an indoor swimming pool besides. The wisdom and imagination of children. Well, one of the most justified criticisms of the church over the years has been its seeming obsession with setting up boundaries between who's allowed in the church and who is not. We have judged, we have deemed unworthy those who do not look like us, speak like us, or love like us. We have formalized and ritualized ways of allowing people into the church and closing the gate to those who are not going to be allowed access. While on a trip to Italy in May of 2019, our group had a tour of the baptistry in Florence, Italy. It's a separate building from the cathedral or the Duomo in the center of Florence. It's a magnificent structure whose doors are almost as famous as the interior beauty itself. It's a magnificent structure. Now, I suppose I should have known this before, but I was somewhat confused as to why they would hold baptisms in a separate building from the main sanctuary in the church. I reasoned that they should, because baptism is so important, it should have a central place in the main structure of the sanctuary itself. However, we were informed that the reason for the separation is that no one who was not already baptized was ever allowed inside the church. No baptism, no admittance. Who's included among the God's people and who is not? Well, that's an important question to answer, and one which the people of God have long struggled with, even longer than the church itself has existed. The ancient people of Israel in the Old Testament struggled with this very same question. After the Jews had been carried off into exile, they struggled to maintain their national and religious identity, and there was therefore a strong movement to make those distinctions very clear and hard so as not to be absorbed into the larger pagan culture. What you could eat, what clothes you could wear, who you could associate, what professions required extra bathing to become ritually clean, what professions were forbidden, and many, many other rules and regulations were set up to help the people negotiate their time in exile. Well, upon return to Jerusalem, those Jews who had not been carried off, who had remained, who were not practicing the same laws and rules as those returning, well, they were held in rather low regard and really not as true people of God. They were almost considered as foreigners in their own land and could not participate in the religious community unless they conformed to these new practices. The Old Testament books of Ezra and Nehemiah record these struggles and support the position of the religious legalists. But then along comes the prophet Isaiah's words, calling for not exclusion, but a radical inclusion of all people, even calling it Israel's mission to be a light to the nations. In Isaiah chapter 55, he offers God's words, "Incline your ear to me and come to me. Listen so that you may live, and I will make you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and a commander for the peoples. See, you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you." That doesn't sound like an exclusive kind of God. In fact, just the opposite is true. God is calling the people of Israel to reach out to other peoples, other nations, other cultures and races to come and share in God's plan of salvation for all. The covenant, the promise, the contract with David as an everlasting covenant is transformed from one of safety from enemies to one that welcomes former enemies. Well, in our reading for today from the prophet Isaiah, the 56th chapter, God is inviting, again, all nations to come to his holy mountain to worship in the Jews' most holy of holy sites, the temple in Jerusalem. God says, "For my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples." God, speaking through the prophet Isaiah, calls the people of God out from being a people whose identity is built on exclusion from others, now into one which they are active participants in welcoming and calling the whole world to come to the one true living God. I think that Israel's strategy of survival during the exile was never intended to be a forever plan for them. From the time of their ancient ancestor Abraham, they have been called to be a blessing to all the nations of the world. Isaiah's words offered the people a radical change of direction from where they had come. Change is not always so easy to do when it comes to long-held practices and beliefs. It wasn't easy in Isaiah's day, and it certainly isn't easy in our own. Who's in? Who's out? Who's welcome? Who's not? Important questions for the whole church as we in North America struggle with declining memberships and worship attendance. Now, right now, during this pandemic, it's ironic that no one is welcome into worship in God's house, for the doors are closed. A virus that knows no boundaries or no distinctions has forced us apart, and we've had to adapt to virtual worship online or parking lot worship services. We have been in our own little exile of sorts. One day, and I hope that day is much sooner rather than later, we will return and we will gather together in this sanctuary to worship and perhaps maybe sometime even begin singing together again and praising God. We will, however, though, be a different people than we were before. I suspect we'll be more cautious, more careful about who and how we will interact. I know that we have been longing for the normality and familiarity that will make us feel good to be back together and doing things the way they used to be. But our world has changed, our church has changed, and we have changed. And I suspect that we're not going to like these changes all that much. We might be tempted to cling very tightly to the way things have always been, I suppose building our own forts of leaves, as if that can keep change from happening. But that way it often leads to us sitting all alone by ourselves inside with nothing to do. Or we can listen to the words of the prophet from God, the prophet Isaiah, and be open to others, open to the variety and the diversity that the world around us has to bring. Our message of salvation through Christ Jesus will always remain the same, but who and how we will bring that message may indeed change, and we should be open to that. 50 years ago, the Lutheran churches of North America decided that women must be a part of the ordained clergy. It was a decision not universally welcomed, but one that was long overdue. And I have to think, where would the church be if we had not made that decision to have women leaders? At our Eastern North Dakota Synod Assembly this weekend, held online, this important anniversary is being recognized with a virtual procession of the ordained women from our synod. Pastor Carla and Deacon Sharon Neschheim from our congregation were among those pictured. For me, this highlights the importance of how inclusion rather than exclusion has benefited the church and how much more we could be as a community of faith if we were a church that included more people of color, were more welcoming and less judging of others because of who they choose to love, what language they speak, or what country they come from. Let us add some extra rooms to our leaf house of God, that all may be welcomed. For as the prophet proclaims, "For my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples." Amen.